We're going to be looking at the Baroque musical style and how it develops and how it represents, really, more the shift of the way people thought in the Galilean Dynamical as compared to previous musical styles. Okay? So within the sort of broad umbrella of the Galilean Dynamical mentality are three musical style periods. And we use these dates as just convenient sort of organizing dates. There's a lot of fluidity, really, from one side or the other, where maybe in one area, people are still writing Baroque music in 1760, where in another area, by 1720, they've already started exploring things that will lead to the classical style. But if you use these dates kind of as a guideline to organize your historical thinking, then it helps us out. So, in the Galilean Dynamical, what are the key ideas that characterize this mathematical mentality? What's that? Okay, good. Actually, maybe I won't even have to go to the next slide. That's actually the first thing there. So these are the concepts we're going to look at. First, the key ideas that characterize the Galilean Dynamical mentality, and then how we can see those represented in Baroque music as well as in some of the other art forms of the time. Okay? So, as you said, ballistic projectiles. We have this idea, this key idea of motion through time and finding ways to depict motion through time or to explore it or explain it or find it in the things around you. We had Kepler and Newton exploring the motion of the planets, okay, finding new equations, new ways to describe that their motion through space. You have a greater expansion of the role of sailing vessels going between continents, and a huge expansion of what that means for trade, that maybe that garment you're wearing in Germany has cotton that was actually grown in North America and brought over. There's a big shift in the way that people look at money lending and interest. It becomes respectable. In medieval times, in Renaissance times, people didn't think of lending money as something that was a respectable trade. It was looked down upon. It was like, it was usury, is what it was called. It's like, you're taking money from me just to lend me money? That's ridiculous. Now it's seen as capital, an investment, something that grows through time. You also have a new understanding of the way blood is circulating through the body. Okay, so those are just examples of this idea of motion through time in the Galilean Dynamical mentality. There's also an increase in the depth of things. So let's explore that a little bit. Okay? Now, I will not claim to be anything like Terry in terms of being able to tell you things about this painting. But I think that even with just this slight look at it, you can see that there is a huge amount of depth represented in the way that the artist has created this, this image for us. You can see that there's an incredible amount of detail. You can see that the amount of landscape in the painting is rather vast. And the way that the color and the light are used to depict the clouds, it gives you a sense that almost as though the clouds are rolling towards you, that they have a motion to them. So there's a sense that you're in a particular spot and that if you just traveled far enough back, you could get to that building at the back of the painting. Okay? And as I said, there's a lot more in that painting going on, I'm sure, than what I've just told you. But I'm just trying to use it as sort of a case study for motion through time as depicted in the visual arts. In theater, you have the works of Shakespeare emerging. And many of you studied this in ninth grade if you were students at Ross. You have people appearing on stage as characters instead of as types. Okay, instead of having the king being up there as just this sort of pompous figure that looks like a ruler and does stereotypical things, you have kings that are actually struggling with moral dilemmas, and you get to see that struggle through their soliloquies and monologues. You have, if you think of really any of the Shakespearean plays, but it's particularly easy to see in the comedies, you have maybe a group of lovers that have a certain situation they're dealing with, and you have a group of nobles in a certain situation that they're dealing with. And these different storylines going on, they're taking turns on stage, and at some point they collide with each other and interact with each other. So there's just more of a depth to the way that these plots are written as well. And then, of course, you can go even a further level of detail down into the language itself and the wordplay that's used. I actually saw very recently a little segment on what Shakespeare is like if you pronounce it the way that they spoke English in Shakespeare's time. And it's actually even more clever than we think it is now with our modern pronunciation, because there's a lot more puns that you don't understand unless you pronounce the words the way that they used to. But here are some of the phrases that we commonly use in the English language today that were actually invented by Shakespeare in one or more of his plays. Fair play, foregone conclusion, one fell swoop, something disappearing into thin air. People often say, it's all Greek to me, if they don't understand something. The phrase, brevity is the soul of wit, you may have heard that. In my mind's eye. And even the title of the movie, Band of Brothers, is actually a quotation from Henry V. and then furthermore, in the Shakespeare's theater, he takes elements from this Italian sort of improv theater style, the Commedia dell'arte, and he weaves that into his comic scenes. It gives them a freshness. Even though they're scripted, there's a freshness to them because of that interaction. Okay, another one of the performing arts, mathematics. We have the invention of differential calculus in 1684, a new method for finding the slope of a point on a curve by using secants of increasingly small length. Okay, so you want to know the slope of the curve here. Well, you start out by maybe drawing this line and finding its slope, and then you make the line smaller and smaller and smaller, and eventually you take the limit down to zero, and you have an equation that's known as the derivative that you can then use to find the slope of any point on the curve. So why is this useful and how does it relate? Well, it's very useful for calculating anything that is a differential relationship, okay? Anything with a this per that, miles per hour, profits per unit, so marginal profits, continually changing velocities, those kinds of things. On the other side, you have, in 1686, the emergence of integral calculus. So where before you could find the area of a shape that had particular boundaries, like a triangle or a rectangle or a circle, with integral calculus, you can find the area under any curve of any shape. And so a way to understand this is if you want to find the area of this curve, first you approximate it by saying, all right, well, I have a rectangle that intersects at this point, and that intersects at this point, and that intersects at this point. And then you find the area of those, and then you have a very crude approximation of the total area. But if you make the rectangles smaller and smaller and thinner until eventually their width is infinitely small, then you have the integration of that curve or the area beneath it. Okay? Now, I know there are those of you in this class who are actually studying calculus and you know far more about it than this, but this is just, again, a way to tie it in to the overall theme of the Galilean dynamical mentality. Okay, so now let's look at the shift from Renaissance music, which is the dominant style before the Baroque, into the Baroque style. One big difference is in the shift from modality, where you have a set of 8 pitches that have different patterns within them, but are entirely based around melodic relationships, okay? two scales, which are, again, a set of eight pitches, but they are based on chord progressions, okay? So modes are based on plain chant melodies. Last time I was with you, we listened to one of those and how the counterpoint developed from these plain chant melodies. A modal piece finishes on a particular note known as the final for that mode. And each of the modes has a different melodic organization. A scale, again, is based on chord progressions. And so the way that a melody moves through a scale is based upon the underlying harmony that's going on with it. Okay? So the big shift here is the emergence of harmony as a way to organize a melody. Okay? Now we're going to take a look at that in a practical sense and hopefully be able to understand it a little better. Okay, so here is an example of a Renaissance piece, an example of modality. Okay, this is written using modes. We have these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 voices that are each singing his or her own part, all right? And they interact with each other in interesting and very pleasant ways, but they are each individual melodies, okay? This is not conceived of as harmony. It's a pretty brief example. I don't know if you'll be able to make this distinction very well or not, but it ends with this this pitch in the uppermost voice, okay? But it kind of ends with this open sort of sound, okay? If this, and that's because it's a modal piece, and so it's ending on the final of the mode it's written on, okay? If this were a harmonically based piece, I think it would end not on this chord, but probably with something like this. Okay, so that it would go to an A major chord rather than staying on this D minor. Okay, but because D is the final of the mode, that's where it ends. That's where, according to the rules, it has to end. Okay, so hopefully that gives you a little bit of a perspective on that difference between music that is written based completely on melodic interactions and music that has a harmonic underpinning. Okay? Let's contrast this music in a number of ways with the next example, which is an example from the early Baroque period. Okay, I'm going to pause it there for a moment. What are some contrasts that you can hear in this example from the previous one? Okay, so this really sounds like a harmonic progression because of the rhythmic organization, as it sounds like what you're saying. Okay, that there's very little variation in the rhythm between the upper strings and the lower strings. They're moving kind of in these block chords. Okay, so that's one point. I don't want to jump ahead of what you guys might have to say. What else is different between this example and the previous one? What's that?
No voices.
Okay, no voices in what we've heard so far in this example, right? Whereas the previous one was all voices, right? This is another shift. With this expanded role for harmony, there's a bigger role for instruments, okay? Instruments that can play in certain ranges. And in fact, the use of instruments becomes more idiomatic, okay? What does that mean? It means that whereas in previous times, you might write a melody not knowing whether it was going to be played by a violin or a flute or sung by a voice, now you might write something that you know is going to be played for a violin, and so you write it so that it really works well for a violin, whereas it might not work as well for an oboe or something like that. Okay? All right, so other things that you may not have picked up in that brief exposure to the second example, but there is a much more defined sense of accent and strong and weak beats within the music. Let's listen to that again from the beginning. And if I stop it right there, you lose a certain sense of satisfaction, right? Because you can hear where it's going. You can hear where that harmonic progression is going, and you're like, come on, get there, all right? There's a certain tension that's created by the movement of the chords and also by the strong and weak beats within the meter, okay? So the conjunction of these two creates a new sense of motion through time for the listener and an expectation that you're finally going to get back to this. Ah, home. Now let's listen to how it proceeds. What can you tell me about what you're hearing now? What performing forces are being used, and how are they being used, and how do they interact with each other here?
There are both instruments and vocals.
Instruments and vocals, good. All right, and how do they interact with each other? They complement each other, okay? Good. And they do that in one important way is they kind of take turns, don't they? Okay. So you are hearing something pretty substantial going on in the vocals, and the instruments are just sort of maintaining a background. And then the vocals take a pause, and maybe the instruments do something that's a little bit more elaborate. Okay, let's listen to a little bit more, see if you can pick that up. Now the instruments take a turn. Okay, so we call this recitative. How would you describe the rhythm of this section? Does it sound like the singer is tied down to a pattern of like regular accents? It's very free, right? So essentially, you have the orchestra providing a harmonic underpinning to the melody, but there's not a big rush, okay? The singer is kind of free to just kind of fill in the middle, but just arrive in certain points with the orchestra together, okay? That's the whole essence of this recitative style, where what the composers of the Baroque were trying to do was to get back to what they thought was an ideal from ancient Greek times, where if you're going to communicate an idea, that you would be able to understand all the words of that idea. Okay? They were moving away from Renaissance counterpoint, where you had voices that were overlapping each other so that you couldn't really understand the text. They thought in that previous type of music, really the text is just kind of serving the music, it's serving the counterpoint. They wanted to flip that upside down. So here, the music is actually serving the communication of the text. And this is how opera is born, okay? I'm a character on stage. I have these deep feelings. I want to convey them to the audience. And so my words need to be understood clearly, and not just understood in terms of being able to hear their pronunciation, but for me to be able to communicate this depth of emotion that I'm feeling as a character to you, the audience. All right, so some of the important changes of style and practice between the Renaissance style and the Baroque style. We go from having, in the example we saw before, we had six voices of equal importance that were interacting with each other melodically, with their melodic modes in the Renaissance counterpoint style. This changes to where now the important voices are the outer voices, in this case, the singer, who's providing that emotional delivery of a text as a character. And then the bass that helps to underpin the movement of the harmony through time, okay? So you've got the outer voices, the melody and the bass. And then in between, we fill in the harmonies with a continuo. That was often a harpsichord. It could have been a lute or an organ, but something that can play chords, okay? Does this sound at all familiar to you, to have a singer, someone on bass, and someone playing chords? Have you ever encountered any music like that in your own life? Just about everything you've ever heard, right? This is where it started, okay? You can thank the composers of the Baroque for inventing this idea of the rock band, essentially. Okay, as I alluded to before, idiomatic music for instruments arises during the Baroque period. The bowed strings really become popular, and the orchestra becomes this dominant type of ensemble. And we still see this today, even though maybe orchestras in certain cities around the world aren't getting the attendance that they used to. Practically any movie you watch has a score that's written for orchestra. Okay, it's sort of woven into our expectations as 21st century listeners that we're going to encounter orchestra music in various scenarios. And opera is born. Now, I don't know if we have any opera fans here in the class of 2014, but regardless of whether opera itself is something that you enjoy, just realize that from opera is born musical theater, movies, like anything that you've ever seen that involves people acting a role with the involvement of music has its roots in the invention of opera in Baroque times. Okay, so now I would like to look at one further construct, and this comes from not the Baroque period, but from the subsequent musical period, the classical period. Okay, so again, if we look at the convenient sort of guideline dates here, the Baroque period is said to have ended in 1750 with the death of Johann Sebastian Bach. So everyone went to bed that night at the end, and then the next morning they all woke up and had their lucky black-eyed peas and sauerkraut and started writing classical music. It was amazing. No, that's obviously not what happened, but that's just our kind of dividing line for convenience sake, is 1750 to 1825 is the classical period, all right? So I'd like to explore a little bit something called sonata form, which was an extremely widely used structure for organizing music in the classical period, okay? So this was most often used for the first movement of a work that had multiple movements. That would include a sonata, which could be for a single performer on piano. It could be a concerto, which would be for a solo performer on a particular instrument, maybe violin, maybe flute, maybe piano, but with the orchestra also there providing an accompaniment and a partnership. Or it could be a symphony. A symphony is essentially a concerto for the whole orchestra to play. Rather than featuring a particular soloist, it's the entire orchestra that develops the musical themes. In the classical period, composers really liked to show how creative they could be within a particular set of rules. Okay? So it's kind of like a flip-flop. In Renaissance, they followed particular rules for interaction of melodies. In the Baroque, they threw those rules away and decided that they really wanted to follow a harmonic progression with a clear declamation of text. Now in the classical period, it's a new set of rules, but it's an opportunity. If you could write a sonata form movement that impressed people, that it would be not only impressive that the music was beautiful, but also that you had adhered to a particular structure. And as you can see, if you look at this visual of the structure, it has a very pleasing symmetry to it, okay? It starts out with a musical theme that we could call the principal subject or the first theme, okay? And that would be presented in a particular musical tonality, all right? Maybe D major, let's say D major, just as an example, and you'll see why in a second. Then you would have a second musical idea presented, and that would most often be in the dominant key to the first one. So if this is in D, then that's going to be in A major. Then there would be sort of a wrap-up of this first large chunk, which is known as the exposition. Okay? It's the first exposure for the listener to these two musical themes. Then the composer gets to have a really good time developing those themes, letting them play around, move from different keys, interact with each other in some ways, and really just take the listener on a journey of exploration around these musical ideas. Then you have this section known as the recapitulation, where the principal themes return, and they return in the key of the first one, okay? So let's just note that the harmonic progressions are really important to the way that sonata form is organized, okay? Now, this is all very well and good to talk about, but maybe it would be better if we could have a practical example, wouldn't it? So let's take a look at what this pianist has very kindly given to us on the interwebs. Whoops, I pressed the wrong button. No. Go. Okay, this is a piano sonata, and we're going to hear a little bit of the sonata form movement. Okay, so now he's moving from the first theme to the second theme. You can tell that he really enjoys playing the piano and finds that it makes him tremendously important. Okay, so now we've moved to the second theme. Okay, so what we saw in that example was first he played the what he called the first theme in his annotations, what some people also call the principal subject. We saw a little passage that took us from the key of G major to the key of D major for the second subject. Okay, and then there was a closing section, and as the video and audio faded out, we were just heading into the development section where the composer had started to present the opening theme again, but with a different tonality, making it now minor instead of major. Okay? So it just gives you a brief introduction. So finally, let's take a look at how sonata form is used in a symphony. And I'm reasonably sure that all or nearly all of you have heard this symphony before. Okay? So it'll be hard to hear me speaking over the sound of the orchestra, and that's not really what I want to be doing anyway. So I'm just going to kind of point to where we are in the sonata form as we listen to it, okay? In this particular symphony, and this is not uncommon, this section is played twice before the development starts, okay? So don't be confused if I go and then back here, okay? This is a very popular conductor, Gustavo Dudamel. Thank you. Beethoven starts to play with your expectations of where the strong and weak beats fall in the measure. And so this thing that was set up in the Baroque, where you could hear where the music was going, now in the classical, in the late classical, in the start of the Romantic period, they're starting to say, well, maybe you didn't know as much as you thought you did. We're going to take you on a journey, but then obscure where it's going. Okay, well, thank you very much. I hope you picked up a few tidbits there. Have a great day.